Let's look at our scripture reading in Psalms 13, verses 1 through 6. They who praise for God's interceding grace. We need you, God. And in Psalms 13, verse 1 through 6. How long will thou forget me, O Lord? Forever? How long will thou hide thy face from me? How long shall I take counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart daily? Shall my enemy be exalted over me? Intervene. I added that word. But he says, consider and hear me, O Lord my God. Light my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death, lest my enemies say, I have prevailed against him, and those that trouble me rejoice when I am moved. But I have trusted in thy mercy. My heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. I will sing unto the Lord, because he hath dealt bountifully with me. And let every heart pray. Father, in the name of Jesus,
yes, Jesus,
we thank you and we give you praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Today I bless your
that happens when the church.
Inside.
And begin to strengthen your mind. God's going to stop some addictions today. There's individuals who've been sick in your body, and doctors have told you you're going to lose this fight. When you serve a God, you say, I got you. I'm bigger than a sickness. I'm bigger than an affliction. I'm bigger than any change that's on you. How many believe God can? Grab your neighbor by the hand. Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, you're a big God. You're a big God. You're bigger than anything that we can even imagine. You're bigger than anything that we can even dream of. Lord, you're a powerful God. We have not seen any power like yours. Lord, you are a merciful God. We have not seen mercy, not like yours. Lord, you're a great God. We have not seen grace, not like yours. For this great, mighty, powerful God, we're knocking on heaven's door this morning. Lord, we want you to break every single shame. Chains that afflicted my brother, chains that afflicted my sister, chains that afflicted my nieces, my nephews, my cousins. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we're not asking the mountain to move. We're commanding the mountain to move. Hallelujah. Mountain, get out of our way and be cast in the depths of the sea where you belong. Mountain, move out of our life. Move out of our finances. Mountain, move out of my body, move out of my home. Mountain, I'm not asking you to move, I'm commanding you in the name.
Jesus, sing.
My
She asked for the head of John the Baptist because John the Baptist said you should not have your brother's wife. John the Baptist is incarcerated in prison. He hears that his head is coming. Can you imagine being John the Baptist preaching the gospel of repentance out in the wilderness, baptizing people and doing everything that God has instructed you to do, but yet now you are incarcerated for telling the truth, and then you get a message in prison? Tomorrow, your head is coming off. John the Baptist sends a message to Jesus. Ask him a simple question. Are you the one? Should we look for?
All right.
Saints of God, you need to know when you stand up for the truth, there's going to be some situations and some consequences. And some of us have kept our mouths shut that we don't upset people with the truth. We don't want to say that because we don't want nobody to get mad at us for telling them the truth. I'd rather you be mad at me and make it than happen, or be happy with me and go ahead. When are we, saints of God, going to stand up for the truth?
Yes.
John the Baptist loses his head. That is King Herod Antipas. He's also the one that just before Jesus' crucifixion, they brought him to his court. The Herod was a terrible maniac, terrorist. After him comes King Agrippa, Herod Agrippa. Herod Agrippa comes during this time that we're going to read the scripture dealing with people. Herod Agrippa is just as crazy as the rest of his relatives. They're all crazy. He decides that he's going to persecute the church of God. You got to be careful when you persecute. Decides, just for the pleasure of the people, that he's going to kill James, the brother of John Mark. And while he kills James, he decides that I'll take the heat around also. So he incarcerates Peter, puts Peter in prison, and in the end of the court of the prison, binds him with two chains.
Keepers before the door.
chains fall off because the church began to break. The chains fell off. And I'm going to tell somebody today, the chains are coming off today. How many believe that? The chains are coming off today. I don't care what your situation is, I just stop by to tell somebody it's coming off today.
Thank you.
If you believe it's coming off today, just say, do it, Jesus.
Do it, Jesus.
Ah, hallelujah. Somebody just give God a praise. Not only did Jesus talk to Peter, but Peter had courage. of God. In other words, Jesus was telling Peter that this thing must happen. If you look at your scripture, you look through your scripture, you find that Peter was always stepping up in order to be a spokesman for Jesus, a spokesman for the disciples. But Peter had a special relationship with Jesus. If you remember in the scripture, when the storm was on the sea, or when the disciples was on the boat, it was Peter who looked at Jesus coming across the water. I'm almost finished. It was looking at Jesus coming across the water, and Peter looked at him and said, "Lord, can I come out on the water?" Now, thanks to God, most times when we preach this scripture, we preach this scripture always from Peter sinking when he saw the storm. We always give Peter slack him because he began to sink when he saw the storm. But this story was not about Peter sinking when he saw the storm. This story was all about Peter having enough faith to step out of the boat. You know, when you step out of faith, a whole lot of people are going to be doing a whole lot of talking and tell you and your brother and mama why you should not be out there. This story is not about Peter sinking when he saw the storm. But this story is all about Peter having enough faith to step out of a boat when he and Jesus had come. Do you not know that Jesus is looking for some old folks that's willing to step out of the boat? Yeah. Too many folks are sitting in a safe place, afraid to get out of the water.
Yeah.
But God is looking for some water walkers. He's looking for some folks that will step out of the ark of safety and begin to walk on the water. Now let me just tell you something. When you walk out on faith, it's going to get scary. When you step out on faith, it's going to get bumpy. It's going to get rough. Because faith can be a very scary thing. But if you have enough faith in God, you're not going to sit where safety is. But faith will take you beyond your safe place. Faith will make you go buy something that you can't afford. Faith will make you go someplace where you don't even know where you're going. But when you step out on God, you can't lose when you step out on God. And even though we preach that Peter began to sink, Peter is the only apostle, disciple, preacher in the New Testament that got the testimony, "I'm lost on the water." Can I just share my testimony just for a second? And then I'm going to close. Everybody said, me and my wife was a fool at 60-something years old when we decided we were not going to sit in the boat no more because God was doing something special in my life. I could have sat in our churches and we could have been in a safe place. But God was moving on the inside. God was doing something different, saints of God.
Had no business.
Church begins to move.
light is on. Come on. The light is on.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Lift those hands and just let God know this is for you. We get out of here. We leave. Come on, just say hallelujah. 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 Bless that young man, Lord. Give him everything that he's praying. Mary Seeks a Sacrifice.